In the previous video, we did a summary of the first chapter of African Catfish Farmer's Handbook, with focus on 7 reasons why fish farms don't succeed. This video promises to be highly educative as Mr. Willie Florin elaborates more on the 7 reasons why fish farms don't succeed. He also x-rays the aquaculture industry in Africa. This is the first in a series of lectures that will be coming your way. So please do well to subscribe to our channel so we'll keep you updated. We are also looking forward to getting your feedback in the comment section below. So if you're ready then, let's get started with the lectures. My name is Dominic Yodo.
We have Mr. Willie. You can see he's in the mood to teach today, and he's going to be telling us a whole lot about the points he had raised earlier. But before we do that, before we dive into that, the introductory part of this book says aquaculture is the production of aquatic organisms such as shrimps, fish, shellfish, and seaweed. And I mean, a whole lot is here. This is the more reason why you need to get your copy of the African Catfish Farmer's Handbook. Mr. Willie, how well is aquaculture in Africa?
Okay, thank you, Dominic. Yes, Africa and agriculture are not going so well together. Many places in Africa, there's hardly any fish farm, for one or the other reason. But of course, we have some highlights. And let me write them down. When you go to Egypt, you see a lot of tilapia farming. You know they have the Nile.
Oh,
that
yeah.
is the biggest source of water.
Yeah.
They love to eat tilapia, although it's not so easy there because water restrictions are there, because they're also using it for agriculture, not only for aquaculture.
Okay.
So there's some competition also going on. Then the climate in the winter time is quite cold. So the growth in the winter time for tilapia is very low.
Oh.
Compared for the summertime. You know, when you live in equatorial Africa,
yes.
you don't have summer and winter. You okay. have the dry season and the wet season, so to say.
Exactly.
So Egypt is actually number one and mainly producing quite small-sized tilapia.
Oh,
number
okay.
two, proudly said, where I'm living, in Abuja, Nigeria.
Oh.
Nigeria is number two.
Interesting.
But in the contrary, it's not tilapia.
Okay.
It's mainly catfish.
Interesting.
So, when we talk about production figures, this can be over 500,000 tons. Nigeria is maybe doing something like 300,000 tons, which is 90% catfish and 10% tilapia.
Interesting.
The third country, I would say, is Ghana.
Oh, really? Ghana?
Also West Africa. And the main reason is also, they have a good source of water. They have Volta Lake, is one of the Volta Dam,
okay.
It's one of the biggest dams in Africa, with fantastic water, and they do a lot of cage farming.
Cage farming?
Cage farming, yes. I think in my book I didn't write much about cage farming, because cage farming and catfish is not the best. It is possible, but I don't like it so much.
Oh, I
see.
But
tilapia is excellent, it's the solution for many places, but for catfish in cages, I see some little problems.
Interesting.
Yeah. So when you look at Nigeria, Nigeria on its own is a very big country. I think it's about 1,000 kilometers from the south to the north, or
yeah.
even more. And from the west to the east is also almost 1,000 kilometers, or
yeah.
something similar to that. Two places are actually not so successful for tilapia, for catfish farming, because it's too cold. You have two places, Taraba State in the highlands and the Plateau State in Jos. Those places you hardly see farms, fish farms.
Why?
But of course,
the weather, the climate?
Yeah, it's too cold in the night.
And fishes don't like the cold weather?
No, fishes, they like 25 to 30 degrees.
Interesting.
So, especially catfish and tilapia, they are warm, they are tropical species. And even when the water temperature goes below 20 degrees, they will even suffer and you can even die from it.
Interesting.
So, that's why, you know, Dominic, you see the best Irish potato coming from Jos.
I see.
Because they love the cold nice.
I get, yeah, I get.
No, don't try Irish potato in Abuja.
It will not work. Yeah. This is interesting.
But the most of the production in Nigeria started actually in the southwest. That means Lagos, Oyo, Ondo State, Ekiti, Kwara State. Then we have some fish also going towards the east. That means Edo State.
I see it.
Delta State. Then, of course, we have also some fish farms where I am based.
Abuja.
Is at FCT.
Yeah.
And Kaduna and Kano.
Interesting.
When you go to the far north, actually I built a farm in the far north in Samfara.
How possible was that?
You think it's desert there?
Yes.
Actually, the season of rain is very short.
Oh.
It is extremely hot and also can be quite cold in the Hamartam.
I see.
But they have very, very strong boreholes with a lot of yield.
Okay. So,
then we talk about the location and then I will come back to that one.
You talk about that. Okay. Okay.
So, fish farms are actually also in Nigeria concentrated in a couple of areas.
Okay.
The north and the east is not as much as in the southwest and the south. Let me say it like that.
This is interesting. I must say that I find a lot of very, very interesting facts here. You said, of course, Nigeria is blessed with lots of water bodies, 264 medium and large dams with a combined storage capacity of 33 billion cubic meters of water.
Yeah, we have a lot of dams in Nigeria everywhere.
That is interesting. Well, anyways, I know that when we dive deeper into talking about some chapters of this book, you shed more light on these points. But then, going back to our chapter one, reasons why fish farms don't succeed. Just like we talked earlier, you said you were going to dissect each of those points, the 7 points you listed in the first video. You were going to be talking deeper about them. Our point number one there was the location is not appropriate for fish production. That is one factor why fish farms don't succeed.
Yes, I you told you already. I have distinguished 7 factors why fish farms not succeed.
Okay.
One is the location, and that is the most serious one, because many people come to my farm and they say, I already built a farm somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Then to find out that they have built it in the wrong location. You know, a farm, you cannot build it somewhere else.
Exactly.
The structures are buildings, ponds, concrete ponds, iron structures. It's not easy to put it somewhere else.
Exactly.
So when you choose the wrong location, and you have missed, all your investment is actually waste.
Wow.
Now I will give you a few points, which sounds so obvious for you, maybe, but for many people it's not that obvious. It's water. Fish farm you produce in water.
Okay.
But if I ask somebody who has already started or a beginner in fish farms, he will never tell me how much water he has. He will tell me, I have a plot of land, so many acres,
yes,
so many plots, so many square feet, whatever they tell me.
They
know exact. If they have already built something, they will tell me, I have 20 ponds of 20 feet by 10 feet.
Oh yeah.
And I tell them, fine, you have 20 ponds. What about your source of water? They say, I have enough water. But enough is not a figure.
I see.
Because, to be honest, water consumption is related to the production. The more you feed, the more you have to flush and get rid of your waste. So water is crucial. Having said that, there are other things which are also crucial. But the most obvious thing is water.
Interesting.
So know your source of water, know the quality of your water, know the quantity of your water. If you have that, then I can give you answers. But there's something else which you have to realize. Drainage.
Okay.
I had one guy in Edo State. He wanted to build a farm in a valley. The man had plenty money.
Mm.
He wanted to build a massive fish farm.
Okay.
But I realized all this wastewater is not going anywhere.
Oh, really?
It cannot go into a canalization, it cannot go to the gutter, to the river, to anywhere. So that means when you are flushing water, you will create a lake.
Somewhere.
And that lake can be on somebody else's land.
Yeah.
And it will cause a lot of problems, and also maybe smelling aspects can be involved, extra mosquitoes. This is not the way. So if you do a farm, better be sure, where are you bringing your wastewater? Because a drainage system, like you do for your household in a septic tank,
yeah,
is not working in fish farm. Forget about that one. It's not working. Drainage is key.
So now, sorry to cut you there, but then when you talk about drainage, what I think now is, in civilized environments, let's say you are living in an estate, you're living in an environment where, of course, it's obvious that there's more civilization there. Does it then mean that fish farmers cannot build a little farm around? How can you then do a fish farm in a civilized environment?
If it is a small farm, it's well maintained. Your fish, if they die, you dispose them in a proper way. You bury them so that a smell of a dead fish will not start to influence other areas in the residential area.
Okay.
Yeah. If you do smoking in a very big way, all those things you cannot do in a residential area. But a backyard farm, a small little farm, producing a little output of fish, it will not have any impact as long as you create a proper environment.
I see.
And you flush your water in time so that the water is not smelling, and you have a gutter system which is going to be linked outside the road, then there's no problem.
I see.
It's only when you don't maintain it very well, that fish are piling up somewhere in the corner, you will create a problem for yourself and for your neighbors.
Interesting.
Then you cannot consider this as a business for residential. But once again, when you do it small and you keep it clean, fish farm is not a smelling business. Are you smelling something here?
No, this place smells really good.
You produce 250 tons in a year. So you don't smell anything here. So it's a matter of keeping your place environment clean.
I see. Obviously, Aqua Gardens is very clean. It looks so serene, and I must tell you that it smells really, really, really nice.
Our third point, which is very important, is the accessibility to the farm. Because at the end of the day, your staff has to go to the farm, customers have to buy your fish, isn't
it? Okay, of course.
So one potential farmer, I told him to have the assignment to see a place where there's a river and land.
Okay.
Because with the river and land, you can say you have water and you have drainage.
Exactly.
So he took me in an afternoon, I took my own pickup, he took his own normal car, in a very terrible road, and the road became worse and worse. It was already from 3 o'clock, it became 4:30, 5 o'clock.
Oh.
And we passed a small river. But the river was actually dry. I told him, I say, see, I see the weather. You don't see the weather. This weather is going to change. And if there's a big shower, small river will be something else.
Exactly.
So we finally found the place. It was a sugarcane plantation on the riverside. It was a beautiful area, but I said no. For him to sell those fish, he has to take them to the market. It will be an extra cost.
But
what happened on the way back? My prediction came out.
It rained?
It rained.
Oh.
I could carry my car over that stream.
But
he got even a failure on his car, and the water was already getting higher.
Oh my God.
I don't know what time he came home, maybe he left the car and he went on tracked back home. But now I told him, now you understand what it means, accessibility.
Indeed.
So, accessibility comes also back to something else. Market. And security. Because if the place is very remote, where are your customers?
In your market.
So, you like to farm fish where your customers are. Customers with buying power. People who can buy really serious quantities of fish.
Yes.
If you want to do a serious business, you need a good market.
Yes.
Market is actually
everything.
Almost everything. Actually, market should be your starting point.
I see.
If there's no market, the rest is not interesting anymore.
I guess.
If you cannot sell your product, then everything is not applicable for me.
Yes.
Yeah. So, security. Something which is springing up in the last few years, especially in Africa,
Yes.
But it's not only Nigeria.
Yes.
Go to the north of Mali. Go to the north of Kenya. Mm. I don't know why it's always the north of a country where you see all those bad boys hanging out.
It's really unfortunate.
Rebels, bandits, even armies.
It's really unfortunate.
And so when you have a farm on the road from, example, Guagalara to Kaduna,
yes,
where kidnapping is almost on a daily basis.
Yes.
Do you like to go to the farm every day?
Certainly not. Certainly.
Very soon you'll be a part of kidnap. So, and you think it's a story for outsiders.
Exactly.
But my friend in Zamfara, he called me. He said, hey, where did you hang out last week? He said, I was with the kidnappers for almost 10 days.
Wow.
I said, I had to pay almost 2 million naira. My family had to pay me 2 million naira to free myself. Really, I need money. I'm broke.
This
so
is terrible.
Kidnapping is not for only to see in the newspaper.
It's real.
It's very real. So don't start a farm where you, at the end of the day, you're always sweating on your steering wheel that you had made it.
I see.
Then infrastructure. Infrastructure is not 100% needed. Infrastructure, I need power. Electricity, yes, from the grid.
Yes.
You know, electricity from the grid in Africa, but also in Nigeria, is not always that good.
Yeah.
But without electricity, you can make your own power. Nowadays, with solar generator, more conventional.
Yes.
And if you have water from a river, you can use a pumping machine on diesel.
Exactly.
You don't need generator to make an electrical pump. You can directly power the pumping machine on a diesel engine.
Yes.
So there are ways to overcome that one. So, but of course, if you have power and the power is a bit safe,
yeah,
let me say a bit stable, it's a big plus. It makes life easy, especially for people to stay.
I see.
Yeah, because they need some light. Yeah.
I see. So
I think, let me go to this and project all those points on this particular farm.
Okay, please tell
us. You like that?
Yes, please do that.
So that you can make, you can show in points
how all of these.
If you have water, how is it? You can even do for yourselves when you do search for a good location. Because when you want to start a fish farm,
yes,
don't start from something because you want to do it in your village, because you want to stay in your village. Don't use sentimental IDs.
I get that. That's a very important
you
one.
You start because you want to start a fish farm, not because you want to create jobs in your village where there's no way you can do a proper fish farm.
Yes.
Then you are using sentimental reasons.
Yeah. It makes a lot
do
of sense.
Do something which is good for that area.
Yes.
And if fish farming is not good, forget about fish farming. Do chicken or do something else.
I think
like
that
I told
is
you in Jos, the climate is not good.
Yes.
For example, Kenya. You know, we are talking about three countries actually.
Yes.
But there are more hotspots in Africa.
Okay,
we have some in Victoria Lake.
Okay.
In Kisumu, is in Kenya.
Okay.
There it's also quite hot. And they like to eat tilapia. They do cage farming. Like they're doing it also in the dam, the Kazumbu Dam, Volta Lake.
Oh,
yeah,
that is interesting.
So that is, for example, Uganda and Kenya. There are also some hotspots of farming.
I see. Yeah? So,
but the rest of Kenya is actually not so good because it's a fantastic climate, but not so fantastic for fish farming.
Fish farming.
Because, let's say, Nairobi is above 1,000 meters of sea level, so the nights are very cold. The Kisumu is low. And the water body is very stable in temperature. And of course, we have also some farms in Mali, in Ivory Coast. Then a very interesting country is Congo DRC.
Tell me more about it.
Congo DRC, they love to eat catfish.
Oh.
And I think that one can come up very well. And the prices for catfish are extremely high. It is actually very strange because the population is poor, but the food items are very expensive.
Strange.
So I don't know how they can cope, to be honest. So sorry to interrupt you on this one, because I jump back to my introduction.
Exactly.
Yeah? But you know, this is my style of doing lecture.
Yeah, yes.
So all those things, let me project it on this farm.
Okay.
Briefly.
Yeah.
Light. I have, let me say, 70 to 80% light from the grid, because I'm in town. Okay. With a quite a good location where there's proper light.
I see.
I have water from a dam. Not from the river, because the river you see here at the back is the spillway of the dam.
I get it.
Yeah, but I take it from the dam.
Oh.
But in another chapter, I will come back on water.
Yes.
In detail.
Okay.
So I have city council water, or how do you call it? City council water?
Yeah.
So what? I have actually
a water bottle.
Rural water, city council water. I have dam water. I have three sources of water. And I have also that in quite reasonable volumes.
I see. I can hear the water behind there.
Then, yeah, you hear the word market.
Okay.
And in town.
You're in Jabi.
The biggest fish market is 3 kilometers away from this location.
I
2 to 3 kilometers.
The Jabi fish market.
Kado.
Kado, okay.
Fish market is okay. Very close to this place.
Oh, I see.
So I have the customers next door.
Indeed.
And they like my fresh fish.
Indeed.
Because Nigerians are very particular when it comes to freshness of fish. You know that they know fish.
Exactly.
Africans in general, when they buy fish, they know about fish.
Yes.
They don't buy that fish. They don't like it.
They like it fresh. They want to see the moving.
Even if you see people on the roadside with fish, even if it's dead, you will still do like this. So that everybody thinks he's still alive. The market is then buying power. Because I noticed one thing. I start a fish farm in Western Kenya, in Mumias. They like to eat fish, but they don't have money.
Oh.
They will buy maybe 2 little fish of 300-400 grams together.
Oh.
For maybe 200 shilling or 300 shilling. Yeah? There's no money.
I see.
But in Abuja, there's also money.
Oh yes, there is.
Because this, especially because it's not a place where there's the industrious,
yes.
But there's a lot of civil servants.
Exactly.
And you have steady income.
You have steady income, indeed.
So that is one of the things, market. Because I'm in town, the security is also high.
Yes.
I told you, I'm already next to the river and I have water. So all these points, I'm on a very high level.
I see.
So that's why I got this opportunity to start this fish farm. I told my wife, when I look at my strength, weaknesses, opportunities and threats.
Yes.
I think I score
very
high.
Indeed.
So if I cannot make money in this farm, I cannot make money anywhere else in Nigeria.
Mm.
Because all the points are, location is good. Of course, this is not, if you have all this,
it
can still fail. Because we still come to other points.
Indeed. Because, in fact, when you were talking about location, it almost felt as if we have covered almost all the key factors. But then I looked into the book again, I said, wow.
Which factor?
Lack of knowledge and bad consultancy.
Okay, good.
Tell me more about that, please, sir.
I will start with this farm again.
Okay.
Because this farm started with somebody else.
Really?
Yes, but he was not doing it well. So at a certain point, I told him, you're sitting on a gold mine, but you cannot dig out the gold. Because he was lacking the basic knowledge to start with. So at a certain point, he got demotivated. Because if things are not working, you will just run away.
Exactly.
So the things are even getting worse.
I get.
You're not supervising that you come to all the other points.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
So at a certain point, he said, Willy, I am going to remember you the words you said to me. I'm sitting on a gold mine, but you don't know how to dig it out. Please, buy my land. But the price he was, offering to me, I couldn't afford. So he came with an idea. Let's do it together.
Beautiful.
Let me hand over the gold mine to you. You will start digging it. And that's what we are doing now for 2 years. And he's satisfied.
I see.
And I'm also satisfied.
It's obvious. What I see here is success, to be honest.
So we are growing fish, we are producing them, we are selling them. We have too many customers. My market is actually more than what I can give. So we are good. Because he actually took this part. This part for me.
Exactly.
And also the other aspects which we are going to
talk about.
Because in Nigeria, there's a lot of people, they claim that they are experts. and their stories are too good to be true. They tell you, you can do this one on this land, you can put so many fish in this tank. And you know, people like to hear the smooth stories.
Oh yes.
The truth is sometimes a bit harsh and a bit bitter.
Exactly.
Because it only comes with hard work and investing.
Exactly.
So, if you fall in the hands of those people, you can lose a lot of money. Because the sweet words is enticing you to go with them.
Exactly.
That's why I'm telling you, this book can save you hundreds of millions if you want to do it on a big scale, but a minimum fish farm will cost you at least 1-3 million. And a book like this can help you to avoid to fall in the trap of a charlatan.
Yes, those quacks.
Quack.
Yes.
Correct, a quack.
Yes. Indeed. So, lack of knowledge of bad consultants becomes another very key factor that is responsible for some fish farms not succeeding. What then is the next one we should consider?
Yeah. I think lack of funding is also a very serious part.
Yes. You know, when I think of that, well, all I imagine is maybe one was hoping on some kind of funds before starting and the money didn't come. Or is there another view to that?
No, when you start a business, also when you start a fish farm.
Yes.
As long as you don't consider it as a hobby, then it doesn't matter. But if you start a business, you have to do a feasibility study. You have to count your cost of investment. That starts with acquiring land.
Okay.
Put all the structures in place.
Yes.
Then the next step starts. Start farming the fish.
Exactly.
That means you start stocking the fingerlings or juveniles, buying feed, take care of them
for
5, 6, or 7 months till you are ready to sell.
Exactly.
But most farmers, they consider the investment. They don't consider the operational cost, building up your stocks. Yeah? Like in my farm, I told you I produce about 250 tons in a year.
That's incredible.
What do you think? How many kilo I have in the farm, which never comes out? Because I have a stock in my farm. What I sell, I restock. What I sell, I restock. I have a stock in my farm. That is up to 52,000 kilo.
I see.
So 20% of my yearly production is always swimming in the water. That is an additional cost. Or an additional investment. Which you have to calculate in your initial plan.
I see. I get it. It's making a whole lot of sense.
50,000 kilo nowadays represent a value of around 40 to 50 million naira. Or let me say $100,000. So assume you start this size of farm and you just have $20,000. You start stocking according to the program.
Yeah.
Your fish are 200 to 300 grams and your money is already gone. Before the month ending, your salary is already finished.
You're stranded.
So you never come back.
I get.
You know, in our review, he said, de ogen zijn groter dan de maag. You know my Dutch proverb?
Yes.
You start something you cannot handle.
Indeed.
Or you start something you don't want to put more money inside. You have the money, but you refuse.
Yeah.
Because you get scared at a certain point.
Indeed.
So handle what your stomach can take.
Not
handle what your eyes want to take. Because many people, especially rich people in Nigeria, when I tell them, oh, this farm, it can make 2 million naira profit in a month.
Yeah.
You know what they say? Really? It's too small for me. I'm a big man. So if you're not happy with your small money, yeah, leave it.
Exactly.
Leave the fish farm. Run away to another business which is more profitable.
Yes, that brings in the big fund faster.
Yes. So lack of funding is something, it comes back in other chapters.
Yes.
I will give you another example of lack of funding. Very simple for a small scale farmer. Can I do that?
Yes, please.
For the ones who just say, I'm not into 250 ton, I just want to do something in the backyard.
Yes.
When you buy 1,000 fish in Nigeria, You want to know what size you want to grow them. Yes. Either it's a smoking size or is stable size 1-1.5 kilo.
Okay.
If you know you want to grow them to 1 kilo, let's make it simple.
Yes.
1,000 fish, you grow them to 1 kilo, your bottom line, you harvest 1,000 kilo, isn't it?
Yes.
Now you need to know how much feed do I need for that. We come to something which we are going to discuss also in the next paragraphs.
Okay.
You need to know how much feed do you need to grow 1 kilo of fish, isn't it?
Indeed, indeed.
With a good quality feed nowadays in Nigeria, you use about 1.3 kilo to grow 1 kilo of fish.
Wow.
This is my result, what I'm getting here.
I see.
The table-sized fish.
I see. Yeah?
So that means 1,000 kilo of fish represent 1,300 kilo of feed. How much is a bag of feed? A bag of feed is about 7,500 naira at present. And I need about, let me say, not 200 bags, that is too much. Let me say, not 100 bags, let me say about 80 bags.
Yes.
If it is 80 bags, I need grosso modo around 600,000 naira worth of money. I buy my fingerlings, let's say they are 30 naira. 1,000 times 30 naira is 30,000 naira. So my direct cost, what I need to have the fish in the feed.
Yes. I'm
talking about pumping of water, paying for the security, paying for the farm manager.
Yeah.
I need 630,000 naira. If you don't have this money,
you don't start.
With your stock, then your eyes are bigger than your stomach.
Yeah.
So you have to downsize your business to the size of your pocket. You follow me?
Very, very valid.
Lack of funding.
Very valid.
It's very common, though.
Yes, yes.
And you know, in the road of growing fish, there are always moments.
Yes.
You need the money for another location.
Exactly.
The school fees.
Yes.
Hospital bill.
Yes.
There can always be something which can take that budget away.
Yes.
So you have to even give it a margin, so that even if there's some other things going on,
yes,
you still have the money to do that initial business, and you make a profit at the end of your cycle, your growth cycle.
Very, very well said. Very well said, sir. Another point I found very, very interesting, as the reason why fish farms don't succeed is facilities poorly built and poorly set up.
Yeah.
Tell me more.
When you start a fish farm, it's a highly capital intensive business.
Yes.
The feed is expensive. You are pouring a lot of feed in the water, and the ponds are poorly built. They start to leak.
Mm.
Yeah. The piping system is done with the weakest, small, thinnest pipe.
Oh.
The pipes are too small. There's no good drainage. Don't consider a fish farm a hole in the land.
Mm.
You dig a hole, you put water, put fish
you're
there. No. There's an inlet, there's an outlet.
I see.
There's so many things are involved.
Sadly.
If it is in the backyard of the house, it is just simple, a pond. But if it is in a standalone place, somewhere outskirts of the
city,
yeah, you need so many other facilities. You need a feed store, a material store. You need a water tank. You need little admin. You need for the farm manager to stay the night.
Exactly.
Not everybody can go. You need to fence it.
Yes. Yes. Security.
So you need maybe a gatehouse. You need a sales point. You need so many things.
Indeed.
So that's why also when you start a business and you don't understand your business, yeah,
because
you go and make a lot of mistakes.
Yeah.
Because everything starts with the good location, then the blueprint. You're going to make a beautiful blueprint where you put all the components of the farm. You put them. Like maybe arrange them
accordingly,
so that everything is set.
Indeed.
And give the people an accommodation that they can be comfortable, so that they can at least stay the night comfortable and take care of the fish comfortably. It's not only the fish you take care of, also the people who are taking care of the fish are also important.
Beautiful. And that brings to mind another point here I found out very, very, very interesting is that when there is no supervision and the recruitment of staff is not taken seriously. Tell us more about it, sir.
Fish farming is a way of life, even from the entrepreneur. the investor. He also has to get a feeling of fish. He has to do this thing with passion. So that is not just a money-making business. A money-making business is then you should go to stock markets. Yeah, or you go to Bitcoin.
Exactly.
Or you go to Forex exchange. You know, it's just money involved.
Yes.
But if you see this farm, see this fish as money, you see dollars swimming in the water, you're making a big mistake. A very big mistake. You see the fish swimming in the water because you have to take care of them.
Exactly.
For maybe 4 months, 5 months, 6 months.
Yes.
You understand?
Yeah.
If it's just money, you cannot take, you cannot have that passion for
it.
Yes,
passion.
Okay, let's talk about staff and supervision. Many people, owners of big companies, or they have been in banking, or they were civil servants, they think I employ good people. They say they have qualification.
Yeah.
They know how to do the job. So they don't need supervision anymore. They know what they do.
Yes.
And me, as the owner, I don't need to know everything. Forget. That passion I was talking about.
Yes.
That passion you have for your investment and for getting the thing right, you have to carry it on to your staff. And also allow them to work as a team. You know, in Africa we have one problem. People always are afraid to lose their job.
Yes.
There are two things involved. If they're afraid to lose their job, they want to have some key expertise.
Yes.
With the key for themselves and will not share to anybody else of the team. So that they are irreplaceable.
I see.
But there's another problem. Is the fear to get sacked. So when there's a problem, they will not say, I make a mistake. They will try to put the blame on somebody else. So you now you see, there's no team.
Indeed.
There the coaching has to come in. The owner of this farm has to create an environment which is not driven by fear. You don't set up people. Always encourage them to work together. Because it's a joint effort to make this farm profitable. Not one person can do it alone. Because it needs 24/7 supervision.
Indeed.
One person cannot be 24/7 on the job.
Yeah.
On the job.
Yes.
So I see that many managers, they're making big mistake in that. And of course, there's one aspect which your staff would always have is integrity. Stealing. Stealing is the last point, almost the last point, about why fish farms are not succeeding.
Yes.
Is theft. And the theft is something is rampant.
I know.
In the whole of Africa.
I know.
It has nothing to do with Nigeria, it's an African thing. Even in Europe, they steal.
I see.
So, that means you come back to the basic knowledge. That
yes.
means you do good record keeping. You select your staff. You are also involved.
Involved, yes.
You know what is going on. And you secure all the rules. Yeah?
The loopholes that
you take care of them,
close them,
and you close them.
Beautiful.
That's why if you go around to my farm, we have light and crucial ponds because they were feeding my fish on the river. They come and collect fish.
Wow!
Fishermen.
They were fishing from a pond. Fishermen now left the river.
In the river, you see one or two fish in the whole river. But there you can see thousands. So the temptation is very high. It's very high. And you know what is happening? One of my staff, I think the name was Kajire.
Oh.
I think it is small in Hausa, correct Kajire?
Yeah.
It's small. He pretend he cannot swim.
Okay.
But at the end of the day, he took a bottle of paint, 20 kilo, and he crossed the river. But I thought he cannot swim.
Okay.
But with a big bucket of paint, he was able to cross the river and we catch him there. But he was also collaborating with the fishermen.
Oh.
So theft is most of the time an internal and an external factor involved. You understand?
It's interesting.
So selecting the people on integrity. Give them incentives.
Mm.
You know, I have one guy. He's an expatriate and he employs thousands of people. You know what he has? He has one rule. If you catch a thief,
yes,
even if it's one egg, let's say it's a poultry family, one egg.
Yes.
50,000 is for the...
For the person who caught the thief.
For the Judas. For the betrayer. The one, because Najir, they don't like to say he's a thief.
He's a thief, yeah.
They know. You know, the most thing a Nigerian can say, or an African, really, watch out very well in that particular spot. But you still, and then say, give me names and numbers. They say, no, I cannot be a Judas. But this man,
I see.
He gets 50,000.
Oh, yes.
And it's working.
Everyone becomes the inspector.
For one egg.
Yes.
This one egg has actually happened to one of our staff. Can I tell you that story too?
Yes, please.
Before we are rounding up?
Yes, sir.
So one guy, he is a plumber.
Yeah.
He was doing plumbing work in a poultry farm, in a layer farm.
Oh.
Where the eggs are coming out from the battery.
Yeah.
He was doing some piping. The man said, look at all those eggs. He was working for the company for over 22 years.
Oh my God.
He stole one egg. One egg. But he didn't notice that there was a camera.
Oh.
Because of one egg. Lost his job.
Oh,
20 years, God. 22 years of service.
Oh my God.
So when I saw him, say that egg has paid you a lot, isn't it? But you know, stealing is small and big.
Indeed.
If they steal small, they also steal big. It's just a matter of time.
Indeed.
So there's no tolerance on stealing.
Indeed.
But the theft.
That brings us to that point, yes.
I will give you an example how theft can be.
Please.
So just to give you an idea how wicked people can be. But you can invent so many other stories, overpricing, underpricing, stealing diesel, stealing feed, stealing fish. But this guy, this owner, particular owner, he was very smart. He had a good record keeping. He knew all the numbers of fish in the ponds. He knows the mortality. All is recorded.
Interesting.
So the boys working in the farm, they know that he has the basic records. That if there's fish missing in the pond, there's a problem. So how do they steal? In the night, when the man is going to sleep in town,
yes,
or enjoy himself in a restaurant with his wife, those boys are draining the pond, take the big fish out, and replace them for smaller ones.
Oh my God.
So the number of fish was correct. So how do I know? The man was complaining bitterly, your feed is not good, the fish are not growing, they refuse to grow.
Oh.
I said, but I'm getting results with my feed and you don't get results, there's something else. But
terrible.
I could not figure out that they take the big fish out, replace them for small fish.
Small fish.
Later on he called me, said, really, I found out what they were doing. See, thieving, there's always a moment of truth.
Yes.
A lie cannot be a lie forever.
Exactly.
A thief cannot be not caught. One day he will be caught.
He will be caught.
So the unfortunate thing is, yes, you take care of your staff very well. You make them passionate for the fish farm.
Yes.
You make them a team. You make them be involved in the results. But unfortunate, a high salary only cannot make somebody not to steal.
Mm.
Don't think when you give him a proper salary that thieving will not be there. It's not like that, unfortunately. Then I have to say something that's more or less is applicable for this area.
Yes.
But also in Kenya, I met some people like that. Retired people. Either they are a civil servant or they had a very good job in the commercial sector, in the marketing sector, banking sector. A retirement person is not automatically qualified to become a fish farmer. With other words, fish farming is not a retirement job. Fish farming is a way of life. And that is the chapter I want to cover a bit. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. Willie. I must say that this has been a very, very, very interesting conversation with you. We've learned from your wealth of experience in the aquaculture sector in Africa, Europe, and especially your experiences here in Nigeria. We look forward to a deeper insight into this book, African Catfish Farmer's Handbook, as we journey into chapter 2. Thank you so much, sir.
You're welcome.
Thank you.